much for that introduction. So this project is still relatively in its early stages. Most of what I'm going to be doing is presenting our design and talking about how we want to do this, create a pressure sensor and a pressure switch that's all combined into one unit. So I'll spend most of my time talking about that, and then I'll show some experimental results that I've generated to kind of convince you that this is really an idea that's legitimate and not just something that we've imagined. So first, pressure sensors. You know, there are MEMS pressure sensors are all over the place. We have hundreds of MEMS pressure sensor companies in the United States that are just building things which look very similar to the diagram that I've drawn on the screen here. You have some kind of diaphragm which is suspended over an evacuated back cavity. The ambient pressure then pushes on the diaphragm, causing it to deflect, and then you have some kind of piezoelectric or piezoresistive strain gauges or maybe capacitive sensing, which is then measuring the deflection of the diaphragm and relating that to the amount of pressure which was pushing on it. Now, this is very useful, and obviously it has its place if it's so widespread in industry. However, not all applications really require us to have a continual monitoring what the pressure is at all times. Some applications just require us to know whether or not the pressure has passed a threshold value and to trigger some kind of response when that happens, like flicking on a tire gauge light in a car or some kind of alarm system when it says, okay, pressure is too low, I need to flick an alarm to tell people, alert, that we're not getting ventilation, this kind of thing. So if you wanted to do this, you typically wouldn't use a pressure sensor. You'd use what's called a pressure switch, and that does exactly what it sounds like it does. It switches when pressure has passed the value that you set it to. But to do it with this, you need to take one of these pressure sensors, you need to take a switch, and then you need to put them together and have something which allows them to talk to each other. But if we could make a pressure switch that is just all one unit, it would be really convenient and it would miniaturize the whole thing. So now I kind of want to shift gears briefly and talk about something which is relevant to this pressure switching idea called electrostatic levitation. And so this is a way of capacitively driving a system, but instead of with a parallel plate where you have two electrodes being pulled together, you have this arrangement of electrodes where you have, let's say, a suspended electrode, such as a beam, sitting over three fixed electrodes, and then you place a voltage on these red side electrodes relative to the center, and what happens is that the electric field produced from those wraps around and pulls on the top of the beam more than the bottom, and you get a net force upwards. So this is artificially levitating by these side electrodes. Now, what we've been doing recently is we've been throwing another little complication into this problem by adding a second voltage to that center electrode in green, so that we have now effectively a parallel plate in the middle. So now if we put a voltage on the center electrode, we're calling that bias voltage, we're pulling the beam down. If we put a voltage on the side electrode, we're pulling it back up. So we get some bidirectional electrostatic actuation by using the two voltages. And while there are a number of very interesting things that we've seen with this setup, there are two which are particularly relevant to the pressure switching idea, which I'm going to talk about today. The first one is that this levitation force can produce oscillations and static deflections that are over an order of magnitude greater than the initial gap between the two center electrodes. And this makes sense because when you're pulling things apart, you can actually move them a lot further than when you're pulling them together. And what we've seen here, which has been kind of a headache for us in many of our experiments, is that when you're moving a crazy amount right next to a wall, which is the substrate, you have a very significant interaction with the surrounding fluid, which I'll explain that in a couple slides from now. So we have the dynamic motion of this beam, which is heavily influenced by the surrounding air, and particularly the air pressure, much more so than you would get with a simple parallel plate actuator. The other interesting thing we can do with this is we've created about a year ago what we call a levitating MEMS switch, where if we put the static pull-in voltage on that center electrode, we pull the beam down into contact with that center electrode, and that's like two conductors touching each other, that's closing up a switch. And then if we put a high voltage on those side electrodes, we can actually peel the beam off of its pulled in position. We can lift it out, lift it off, and open the switch. So we have a switch which we can toggle to and from the pulled in position by putting a combination of these, of this bias voltage and these side voltages. Now, it's really nice, this system is we both have a switching mechanism and we have a pressure-dependent system that's all packaged in a single device. And so this is actually what we want to do to make our MEMS pressure switch. So now how do we want to do that? So as I said, this has, when this thing is oscillating and when it's oscillating a significant amount, it has a very strong interaction with the surrounding fluid. Particularly how this interaction manifests itself is through a significant nonlinear damping effect and, more importantly, this squeezed air effect when the beam gets very close to the substrate. So as it gets very close, this cushion of air doesn't have time to get out from the sides of the beam if it's moving at a high enough frequency, and this limits how close we can actually get to that center electrode with the beam. And the amount of limitation that we have through this air spring depends on the pressure. So if the pressure is low, then that beam can just slice right through that air cushion and crash right into that center electrode. If the pressure is high, this air spring prevents it from touching, and we have this effect, which depends on what the ambient pressure is. And now for the switching aspect of it, instead of looking at static pull-in, which I showed in the previous slide, we're going to look at dynamic pull-in. And dynamic pull-in happens when you're below the pull-in threshold for an actuator, but the fact that one of them is moving means that it gets too close to the other electrode, and then dynamic pull-in is then triggered almost prematurely from the standpoint of voltage. So we have the system which can trigger dynamic pull-in depending on how close the electrodes get to each other, the beam gets to that center electrode, and we have this air spring effect which is controlling how close they can actually get together. So then we should be able to relate the pressure that the switch is in and what the threshold dynamic pull-in voltage should be. Now there's one caveat here, which I've kind of glossed over at this point, but it is definitely very relevant for this problem, is that the nonlinearity of this force. Now, ideally, to have the most effect of nonlinear damping and this air spring effect, you want to be driving at the natural frequency. But if you have a nonlinear system, that natural frequency is changing as that oscillation amplitude grows. So this is an experimental frequency response we've done of this system and shows significant softening and a very big bifurcation or hysteresis jump. Once you get to the back of the softening branch. So the way that we're doing this for now, just to demonstrate that this concept is valid, is instead of driving it at a single frequency, we're just going to sweep the frequency backwards across this first natural frequency, so we're sure to always capture that resonant peak. And then we're basically seeing, once we hit the end of that, whether it drops down to that stable branch, that stable lower amplitude branch off to the left, or if it triggers dynamic pull-in and just goes right down to the center electrode. We are putting a large DC voltage and our AC voltage on the side electrodes, and then again, we're setting our vacuum pressure to be constant, and we're applying a constant bias voltage, and we're trying to map that relationship between voltage and pressure. So now the experiment for this, it's a relatively simple experimental setup. We have a data acquisition system giving us our AC voltage. We're passing it through an amplifier, which is putting a pretty large DC offset on this to be able to get a very large oscillation that we want, and that's going to the side electrodes. We have a second power supply, which is giving us our bias voltage, which we're going to use to trigger dynamic pull-in, and then we are measuring beam tip velocity using a Pallay laser vibrometer. So here are two time response, or two data points, I guess, that we have acquired in this experiment. One is at, or they're both at 1.39 torr, that's the vacuum pressure. The left figure is at 9.9 volts bias, and the right figure is at 10 volts bias. So this is happening as we're sweeping the frequency downwards. As we approach our natural frequency, we see our velocity amplitude start to increase significantly as we're hitting our resonance. And then if we look at the end of that curve, we see we have this jump back down to that lower branch. And if we zoom in on this jump, which is shown by that red dotted box for the 9.9 volt case, we see that it kind of gradually decays and then still stays stable the entire time. It's still moving. But if we increase the bias voltage to just 10 volts, 100 millivolts more, and we zoom in on this part, this portion, we see instead of slowly decaying down, the oscillation just suddenly cuts through the air cushion. It smacks into the electrode and the velocity just stops immediately. So we can say if we want this switch to trigger at 1.39 torr, we need to set 10 volts on that center electrode, because if it's below that, it's not going to pull and the switch is going to stay open. If it's that or above, then when the pressure drops below, it's going to pull and then the switch is going to close. So naturally, we don't want to just do this for a single point. We want to do this for many points and show that there is actually a trend between our dynamic pulling voltage and what our pressure is. So we repeated that test for a number of pressures between about 0.7 and 1.6 torr. And if we ignore below 900 millitorr for now, we see that there is a clear trend. As the pressure increases, the dynamic pull-in pressure, or the dynamic pull-in voltage, also increases. So if we want the switch to close, let's say, at 1 torr, we need to put 8 volts on it. Or if we want it to close at 1.4 torr, we need to put 10 volts on that center electrode. And because the pressure is increasing the effect of this air spring and its nonlinear damping, which is limiting the amplitude of the beam as it gets close to the substrate, that's how the dynamic pull-in is being related to the static pressure, because that's controlling how close they can get together. Now, we also see here below 900 millitorr, it seems like it's not changing at all. And this is to be expected at some point, because once the pressure is so low, this air spring effect is not going to be able to fight the momentum of the beam, you know, on its own. So it's going to be able to cut through that air cushion no matter what. So the change in the dynamic pull-in voltage is not going to be that dependent on pressure, because the air spring is just too weak to do anything. But what we do see, which is a little bit unusual, is that it seems like there's this jump that happens where all of a sudden it's not changing at all, and all of a sudden it is. And to be honest, we're not exactly quite sure exactly why we see this jump as of right now. We have done a modeling of this beam, which I didn't have time to get into today, unfortunately, that does a very simplistic dealing of this air spring effect and its nonlinear damping, and we don't see this happening. So we're assuming that this jump is happening probably because of some weird air effects that would maybe show up if we did a more comprehensive modeling of our actual fluid, maybe with like a nonlinear Navier-Stokes equation. So at this stage, we're not exactly sure why this is happening, but we can see that at least at some pressure, this dynamic pull-in can be related to what the pressure in the environment is. So now just what to take away from this. We've outlined a pressure sensor that senses pressure through nonlinear damping and air spring effects instead of an evacuated back volume. We're exploiting the dependence of dynamic pressure on what the pull, or sorry, we're exploiting the dependence of what the dynamic pull-in voltage is on what the pressure is, and we're using this levitation forcing mechanism because we have a very large oscillation that can produce a lot of interaction with our fluid. And this is an ultra-simplistic structure. It's just a beam. We don't have a big pressure diaphragm and a switch and some kind of control system to talk to each other. We just have a single beam, which is doing everything by itself, and we're able to actually show that this is working in our experiment. So we did have some funding for this project through an NSF grant, and now I have a few moments for a few questions.